Hello Cloud Gurus, I'm Janani Ravi. Welcome to Cloud Provider Comparisons. In this series, we take a look at the same cloud service across different cloud providers. We'll explore what's similar, what's different, and other details that may be interesting. In this episode, we'll focus on containers. We'll look at what the different cloud platforms have to offer for deploying and running containerized applications. Before we jump in, let's start with a quick overview of what a container is. A container brings together everything you need to run your application, including dependencies and configuration management, in a single lightweight package. Containers do not run directly on top of your operating system, unlike old school applications. Instead, containers run on top of a container runtime which abstracts your application from the operating system nitty-gritty, making your apps highly portable and greatly speeding up development and release cycles. The most popular containerization technology today is Docker, though there are other technologies used in different ecosystems. Let's get started with the basics. Azure, AWS, and the GCP all support containers and container clusters. You first build a container image, which is just a static file with executable code that can create a container. This container image then needs to be registered with a container registry that allows you to secure access to your container images, manage versions, and a whole lot more. On Azure, this container registry is simply called the Azure Container Registry. On AWS, no surprises here, it's called the ECR or Elastic Container Registry. The GCP also has a container registry. However, given that teams need to manage more than just containers, GCP offers a next-gen container registry referred to as the Artifact Registry. The Artifact Registry is used not just for container images, but for language packages such as Maven and NPM and Debian packages as well. Operating system packages. On all three cloud platforms, it's possible for you to deploy your container images directly on virtual machine instances. However, this infra as a service option has very high administrative overload. In addition, you're dealing with standalone containers, which is not ideal. Standalone containers have several limitations. They do not have the ability to provide replication, auto-healing, auto-scaling, load balancing. These are all must-haves in modern applications. And this is exactly why we need a container cluster orchestrator such as Kubernetes that automates software development, replication, scaling, and load balancing on container clusters. All three cloud platforms have their own offerings of managed Kubernetes. If you happen to have most of your applications running on one of these cloud platforms, whether it's Azure, AWS, or the GCP, you should stick to running Kubernetes on that cloud platform. This will give you great integrations with the other existing services that you're using on that cloud. On Azure, you have the Azure Kubernetes Service, or AKS. On AWS, you have the Elastic Kubernetes Service, or EKS, and on GCP, you have the Google Kubernetes Engine, or the GKE. How do they compare? Well, the short answer is that Amazon's EKS is the most widely used. Azure's AKS may be the most cost-effective option, and Google's GKE has the most features and automated capabilities. EKS and AKS were first released in 2018, and GKE was released way back in 2015. No surprises there, Google originally invented Kubernetes. Both Microsoft and Amazon had their own container orchestration technologies before Kubernetes. However, as the adoption of Kubernetes in the software community grew, Azure went ahead and integrated its service with Amazon Kubernetes Service, and Amazon released a Kubernetes offering in addition to its own offering. Amazon still has its own Elastic Container Service, separate from Kubernetes, for managing container clusters. And that may be the right choice for you if you want very tight integrations with other AWS services, more than what Kubernetes provides. All three services are globally available, but an advantage when using Azure and AWS is that you can run Kubernetes on the government cloud, the special infrastructure that meets the needs of federal governments worldwide. The GKE, that is Google Kubernetes Engine, unfortunately does not have the option to have your cluster run on the government cloud. AKS and GKE are more automated. They will automatically handle security patches on the control plane and upgrade the nodes that make up your Kubernetes cluster. However, upgrades to EKS components and node health repair for EKS components tend to be much more manual. Clusters are by default virtual machines on all three platforms. All three cloud platforms support virtual machine nodes with GPUs enabled if you want that. However, it's only Amazon which supports bare metal machines as your cluster nodes. Both Google Kubernetes Engine and Azure Kubernetes Service have complete command line support to work with Kubernetes. However, you may find that Amazon support for the command line is much more limited. Both Elastic Kubernetes Service and the GKE provide an integrated service mesh which works on Kubernetes, called App Mesh on Amazon and Istio on Google. However, Azure at this point in time when we are recording this does not have an integrated service mesh allowing you to work with microservices. And finally, in terms of scale, AKS can support 500 nodes in a cluster. EKS can support just 100 nodes and the GKE can support up to 5,000 nodes in your Kubernetes cluster. Now, if you're looking for more turnkey solutions using Kubernetes, Red Hat OpenShift is a platform as a service offering that offers OpenShift build and deployment tools in addition to Kubernetes. This service is built using Kubernetes at its core, but it offers IDEs, runtimes, build tools, CI/CD services, a service mesh, and much, much more. Red Hat OpenShift is available as a service on both AWS and Azure, but not on the GCP. Now, it's also possible that you want to be able to deploy and run containerized applications without managing infrastructure and creating clusters. You can do this using something known as serverless containers. Microsoft was the first in the industry to offer serverless containers in the public cloud via Azure Container Instances, where you run containers without using a Kubernetes cluster. On the GCP, you can run containerized workloads in a serverless manner using Cloud Run. Once again, Cloud Run does not need an underlying Kubernetes cluster. AWS Fargate is a serverless offering on AWS that removes the overhead of scaling, patching, and managing servers on your container clusters. An important way in which Fargate differs from both Azure Container Instances and Cloud Run is that Fargate is used to abstract away the overhead of using an orchestrated cluster, either EKS or ECS. It is not used without an underlying cluster. Now, since Kubernetes can be deployed on on-premises data centers as well as on all cloud platforms, it offers a middle ground between infra as a service and platform as a service options, allowing you to work in a hybrid multi-cloud world, which is increasingly important today. Each cloud platform has its own offering to support this hybrid multi-cloud environment. On the GCP, you have Anthos. Anthos is built around a Kubernetes core where you run GKE on your cloud machines and GKE on-prem on the machines in your local data center. Google then uses a single control plane to manage your applications in this hybrid environment. On Azure, you have Azure Arc, that goes beyond managing hybrid Kubernetes deployments. Azure Arc allows you to manage servers, Kubernetes clusters, Azure Data Services, and SQL servers hosted on resources outside of the Azure platform. AWS is not far behind. Amazon EKS Anywhere is a deployment option which allows customers to create and operate Kubernetes clusters on customer-managed infrastructure supported by AWS. Now, there is a lot more to say on container clusters and interoperability in a hybrid multi-cloud world. But that's a topic for another day. That brings this Cloud Comparison Containers edition to an end. Please subscribe and give us a thumbs up if you found this useful. Don't forget to click on the bell icon to get notifications of new content. Thank you for listening to the very end, and keep being awesome cloud gurus.